إن الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه وبعد. We were talking about the importance of tools, and the most critical of the tools, as I explained yesterday, is the issue of critical thinking. Critical thinking is a three-step process, and we'll do the first step today and then we'll follow inshallah. The three-step process: one is awareness of your current situation, what we call a concrete experience, what we call al-idhar unniya, or being in the hazir, complete and full awareness of where I am and what I am doing and why I am doing it. From this, the next step is reflection, tafakkur. What did I do? Why did I do? What else could I have done? And so on. Reflection on that experience. And the third process after that is the process of sabak, of learning a lesson from that experience. So three-step process. One is the huzur, being hadir, being present. So we look at that. What is the meaning of being present, and what does it entail? Now, being present obviously doesn't refer purely to being physically present, and that's understood. But what it means is being present in every sense of the term. Complete awareness, physical awareness of what is happening to me, mental awareness, why I am doing what I am doing, consciousness of that, and what effect it is having on me. Emotional awareness. Is this making me sad, glad, bad, mad, what? Right? Emotional awareness. That instance, this... For example, you are sitting here now in this masjid after Salatul Fajr and you are listening to some talk. What is it doing to you? Why are you here? You could be somewhere else. You chose to be here. Why? Listening to this, what is it doing to you? Complete awareness. Why is that awareness important? Because that is your raw data. For analytical thinking, you need data. And that raw data is your awareness of being in those circumstances. If the awareness is poor, if the awareness is lacking, if the awareness is contaminated, then your basic data itself is contaminated. And then we have the GIGO principle: garbage in, garbage out. So if you start with garbage, you only end up with garbage. You cannot end up with good theory and with good understanding if you start with incorrect or incomplete data. And that is why, see this in relation to the hadith of Bukhari, where Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, innamal a'malu bin niyat. See the context of this in relation to the hadith of Bukhari. Where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say? Innamal a'malu bin niyat. He said the worth of the deed, the reward of the deed, is based on what? The niyah. When does the niyah happen? Before the action, or during the action, or after the action? Before the action. Yes? I mean, you might even make a niyah in between, but ideally, where should the niyah for salah should be made? When? After you finish salah? No. Before you begin. Before you begin the salah, the niyah is in the heart. You don't have to stand there and say, I am now praying 2 rakah salatul fajr on this particular musalla in this masjid under this light. No. But the niyah, you are standing here to do what? You are going to do some yoga exercise or something? No. I am here for salatul fajr. You will not go into the extent. Some of the a'immah said, just being there alone is niyah, because why did you come here? You came here for salatul fajr, so there is no need for anything else. Alhamdulillah, you are standing here for salatul fajr, that is enough. Other people said, no, consciously think about it. Nobody said, say it with your tongue. This is the innovation which we have brought in. And that's because when we were small and people were teaching us, they said, make the niyah like this. You know, like small children. If you ask him, recite the kalma, he will say, kalma tawheed awwal, la ilaha illa. Is kalma tawheed awwal is part of the kalma? No, that is what he has been taught. Because he has been taught, because he is learning now the three kalima, four kalima, five kalima, so which is first, which is second, which is third. And mindlessly, that's a good illustration of a mindless following of religion. Somebody taught you something in order to make you remember. Right? So, for example, somebody is teaching you the three, the Muwaddatayn and Suratul Ikhlas. Qul Allahu Ahad, Qul Allahu Falaq, Qul Allahu Nas. Three Qul. Somebody says, while he's teaching you, small child, the Ustad is saying, okay, Pahila Qul, first Qul. Qul Allahu Ahad. Now this child now is 50 years old. You ask him, please say Suratul Ikhlas. He will say, Pahila Qul, Qul Allahu Ahad. Hey, Pahila Qul, kaise lai, bhai? Is this Quran? Where did you get this first Qul from? From your learning, which at that point made sense, but because now you are mindlessly doing it through your whole life, makes no sense. So also with the niyyah of salah, so also with the niyyah of wudu, so also with the niyyah of ghusl. The niyyah is important. Why? Because the niyyah ensures that you are fully in the experience here and now. Yes? That is why Imam An-Nawawi, rahmatullah alayh, he said in his book, Ar-Riyadu Salihin, Al-Idharu Niyyah Fi Kulli Aqwal Wa Fi Kulli Amal Wa Fi Kulli Ahwal Al-Barizatu Wal-Khafi. He said, the awareness of the niyyah, Al-Idharu Niyyah, the awareness of the niyyah, why am I doing this? Why am I saying this? I am in a particular situation in life, how do I feel about this? Al-Idharu Niyyah, that hazir of the niyyah, being aware of the niyyah, fi kulli aqwal, in everything we say, wa fi kulli amal, in everything we do, wa fi kulli ahwal, in all the situations in life that we find ourselves in, happy situation, sad situation, so on, so on. Al-barizatu wal-khafi, whether this is visible or whether it is hidden. Complete awareness. Now, why is this important? As I told you, first of all, it's important because it is your data. This is the basis of your analytical thinking. And if this data is wrong, then the rest of it is wrong. So this data is important. Second big benefit. When we are standing in Salah, for example, I'll give you examples from Salah. If you're standing in Salah, for example, if you are completely and totally aware of what you are doing, hazir in the system, what will happen to your Salah? Beautiful Salah. That is the meaning of khushu and khudu fi Salah. I'm standing in Salah, I'm completely and totally aware that I'm standing before my Rabb. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jalla wa ala, is seeing me when I'm reciting the Quran. Allah is hearing me, He's listening to me. Yes? Complete awareness. Are your thoughts going to wander here and there? No. No chance. Thoughts wandering means your awareness is gone. You are standing here, but your mind is in your house, in your shop, in somewhere, whatever. Right? So you are now split. Two pieces. One piece is here and the other piece is somewhere floating around. In cyberspace or some other space. Awareness brings that back. Right here. In front of Allah. So, the quality of your action improves. Number one. Number two. Complete awareness of your situation makes you thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It makes you give sugar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. I could have been anywhere in the world, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed that I should be in His masjid worshipping Him. Is there any amal superior to the fard salah at the time of fard salah? No amal. There is no amal which is superior to the fard salah at the time of fard salah. At the time of fard salah, physically you cannot do it because nobody will let you do it, but at the time of fard salah, when the jama is going on, if you are making tawaf of the Kaaba, your tawaf is haram. Your tawaf is not the right thing to do. Your tawaf has no value before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You should have been standing in that jama, praying that whichever salah it was, with the imam and with the jama. So even an action like that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made fard salah the best amal even in jihad fi sabilillah. What is salatul khawf? Time for fard salah comes, even though I am fighting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no ibadah superior to that. That is the peak of iman. But even there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did He say? No, time for fard salah, stand in salah. And because you are fighting in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that methodology of the salah is different. It's not the same like you do here, but Is anywhere in the in Islam or the Quran or the Sunnah to say, no, because I am fighting jihad fi sabilillah, salah is for me, salah is not required? No. Nowhere. The most superior amal. What is the most superior amal? If you find Ramadan, if you have good health, alhamdulillah, Allah has given us, if you are not sick, if you are not traveling, right? If you are not sick and you are not traveling, during Ramadan, during the daytime, what is the most superior amal that you could be doing? Fasting. Fasting. There is no other amal better than that. You cannot say, no, I am going to be slaughtering camels and feeding people all day from morning till night. Why should I fast? I am doing a good. Is it bad? Is it bad to give charity? I am going to sit here and distribute banknotes from morning till night. I will have piles and piles of notes, and I am giving charity and giving more charity and more charity. And while I am doing this charity, I have a snack. So what? So you just committed something which was haram. So now the penalty for deliberately leaving one fast is liable on you. If you deliberately leave a fast without a shara'i reason, meaning that you are not sick and you are not traveling, can you just make up by doing one fast? No. No, you are now subject to a penalty. Just keeping one fast is not sufficient. You have to fast continuously for 60 days. So if you leave 30 days of Ramadan, now do the multiplication. You get the point I'm saying? You have to release a slave. Or you have to, and this is in order. This is in order. It's not, Allah has not given you the choice. Do this or this. No. In order. And the least of that is, fast continuously for 60 days. For leaving one fast, one fard fast. Because that is the most superior amal. So now if somebody who is fully in the present, fully conscious, is he ever going to leave a fast? Will he ever leave a salah? No. If he is a Muslim, he will never do that. And he will thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So benefit number two of being fully in the here and now and fully aware is that you become thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have a headache and you are fully aware that I have a headache. What is part of that awareness? Part of the awareness is that alhamdulillah, inshallah, this is a small headache. I eat one tablet, it's gone. It's not a brain tumor which is giving me this headache. 1 kilometer down this road is the cancer hospital. Go and see how many people there have headaches and see the reason why they have headaches. So what do you do with the headache? You complain, oh my God, what? No, it's Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, forgive my sins for this headache. Oh Allah, take away the headache. Nothing wrong in making dua. But Alhamdulillah, oh Allah, this is a headache. I could have had so many other things. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. You have not given me any of those problems. Yes? You get stuck in a traffic jam. This guy next to you is cursing and La hawla, why am I? You say, Alhamdulillah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me a car that I can get stuck in a traffic jam. Please understand, the chap who is walking on the street, he's got no traffic problems. Have you ever thought of it like this? Your own awareness. The guy walking on the street, he's got no traffic problems. You got a traffic problem. Why? Because you have a vehicle. Should we thank Allah or should we complain? Which one? Alhamdulillah that Allah gave me a vehicle. And the bigger the vehicle, the bigger the traffic problem also. Try driving over. Yesterday I saw a Rolls Royce on this road. I said, who's driving this bus, you know? Who in his right senses will even buy a Rolls Royce in Hyderabad, for God's sake? I mean, absolute senseless thing to buy. You can't park it, you can't drive it. It's a major nightmare to drive that thing in traffic. Some guy comes close to you, you feel very bad. You say, oh my God, is he going to touch my car? La halwa la quwwata illa billah. Think about that. Awareness. Awareness. There's a friend of mine, his mother, may Allah bless her, she had a diamond ring, very expensive diamond ring. She was making wudu one day in the house. She was making wudu, she took it off and put it on the counter and she made wudu. She forgot about it. And then 2-3 days later, she remembered, where is my ring gone? They searched all over the place. It was not there. Very expensive ring. Obviously, somebody stole it. So her sister, her daughters-in-law, sons, everybody, my God, what happened to your diamond? She is absolutely calm and quiet. Somebody asked her, he said, how come you are not saying anything? So in Urdu, I'll translate for those who don't know. In Urdu, she said, "Arey bhai, thi tabhi to gayi na. Allah ka karam hai." She says, "It got stolen because I had it. No, if I didn't have it, it wouldn't have got stolen. Alhamdulillah, Allah gave it to me. It's gone. Fakar khalas. Who's worried? Let it go." Imagine the issue of attitude, being completely in the here and now, thanking Allah. Alhamdulillah, ala kulli hal. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, الحمد لله على كل حال. We thank Allah in every state we are in. Second benefit. Third benefit of completely being in the here and now is immediately as soon as you commit a sin, you become aware of what you did. There's no ghafla. We all commit sins. But the minute you do that, immediately, Allah, Allah, what did I do? Immediately you make tawbah. There's no khafla. It's not that you're committing sin after sin after sin. You know it is wrong, still you are doing it. No. The minute you commit that sin, the moment you are standing in that place, your first question immediately you ask yourself is, why am I here? Why am I in this place where sin is being committed? Why am I here in the first place? Allah gave me two legs, start walking. If something happened, say, La hawla wa quwwata illa billah. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajiun. Immediately make tawbah. Ya Allah, I'm sorry. Ya Allah, I will not do it again. I make tawbah. And no, never go near that. Because you are in the, you are aware in the here and now. So three benefits. Number one, good data. What is happening to me, I'm fully aware. Number two, that makes me thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says, wa lain shakartum lazidannakum. The one who is grateful to me, I will increase the bounties. Alhamdulillah. And the third one is immediately tawbah. Anything happens, immediately make tawbah. Sometimes small things happen, you know, it's not big things. Small things happen. Yesterday, for example, now because we have finished quite a lot of the Quran, the Hafiz, Imam Sahib is reciting less. So we are doing about now one juz or so, maybe a little bit less. So Tarawih yesterday finished by 10:30 instead of normally by 10:40. Normally we finish by what? By about 11, right? No, 11 is after, so it's about 10:45. So yesterday finished about 10:15, right? So we finished about half an hour early. Now, we finish, Alhamdulillah, we say Alhamdulillah, we go. Outside conversation people, thank God, this is the correct amount of time for Tarawih. Should never be longer than that. So I told my brother, you know, Alhamdulillah, Allah gave you mouth, keep it shut and go home. Right? Keep your mouth shut and go home. Go to sleep, man. Allah gave you the time for ibadah. Alhamdulillah, biiznillahi ta'ala, we didn't ask nothing. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reduced it. May Allah give us the same reward, inshallah. Right? Just say, Alhamdulillah, go home, go to sleep. Why must you say kalimat of kufr before you leave? Kufran ni'mat. Kufr does not mean coming out of Islam. But kufran ni'mat. Allah gave you a ni'mah. And you say, well, Alhamdulillah. You say, this is, thank God it is over. I said that 15 minutes, that 30 minutes of Tarawih, 30 minutes of standing in the hudur of Allah, 30 minutes of listening to the Quran, on the day of judgment on your scale, you will cry tears of blood for that. For 1 minute of that. Forget about 30 minutes. For 1 minute of that, the value of that 1 minute of that, you will cry tears of blood, but it will not. You will not get it if it is not there. Alhamdulillah, Allah gave it. Keep your mouth shut. Why must you say nonsense? Why must you speak nonsense? For what? Go home and go to sleep. But if somebody is fully aware of his of himself, he will never do that. So Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me today, I'm going home early. Alhamdulillah. Go home early. Awareness. And that's why I want to end with this. First rule, first tool of critical thinking, critical analysis is complete and total awareness of the here and now. وصلى الله على نبي الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك يا رحمة الله.